Works Festival. Let's have a big round of applause for new plays.
Yay!
Of course, before we get started, allow me to say a few words of thanks. So thanks first to the Metro Nashville Arts Commission, also to the Tennessee Arts Commission. Those folks did indeed provide funds that help make some of this work possible that you'll see today and for the whole festival. I need to say some media thanks to Nashville Scene, to WPLN, and to NowPlayingNashville.com for their support of this festival. And I also want to say a big thank you to Nashville Public Television for providing the equipment that we're using for our live streaming on HowlRound. They are excellent roommates for many reasons, and that's one of them. So thanks to NPT for that. And of course, our biggest thanks of all goes to the woman without whom we wouldn't be here at all. She's someone who loves the theater. She understands what new works do to make the theater a lively thing, and she puts her money where her heart is. So let's all have a big round of applause for Martha Ingram of the Ingram. As long as you are online, maybe looking at some internet play thing read, you might want to go on over to our website. We're launching a membership program for next year, so I'd love for you to look and see if you want to be a member of Tennessee Rep at various levels with different benefits. And also, you know, as long as you're there, you could click on over to the subscription page and get a subscription if you haven't done that already. Next year is our 30th anniversary, and we're mighty proud of that, so you might as well join the party. We're going to be celebrating all year long. We're also having a big fundraising party in a week from today, actually. So if you're a theater lover and you're a Tennessee Rep lover, and you're probably both of those if you're in this room right now, maybe you'll consider joining us for that party. It's a lovely celebration of the season as it's coming to a close. All of the actors who have been a part of all the shows all year will be there, and there'll be entertainment and good food, and it's just a great way to end the year. So we hope you'll consider joining us for that. Okay, a quick overview of the Ingram New Works Project. It's got three parts. The fellowship, the lab, and the festival. The fellowship is a fellowship that we offer to a playwright of national reputation whose work we admire and who we believe with all our hearts will continue to make valuable contributions to the American theater. And we're pleased as punch that this year the person who accepted our fellowship was the wonderful Doug Wright, who's sitting right there. He's writing a play called Posterity, which will be read on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday night this week, so we hope that you'll come and join us for that. And then, of course, there's the lab. This is a season-long lab experience that includes four playwrights. They come to the lab with nothing more than an idea and a dream. Everyone say hello to Nate Epler. By Jeremy Sony. Yay, yay. And of course, the third part of the project is the festival, and this is where you come in. It's really important that you're here. We really appreciate your participating in this stage. At this point, one of the things that we've provided for our playwrights is the opportunity to hear their plays read aloud by professional actors in front of an audience. Everything that you feel and respond to and experience as an audience member is useful information to the playwright. So we thank you for being here to do that. We also have in your programs, there's a little survey form, and it would really be helpful to us if you would take a minute and respond to it. If you don't like dealing with paper, because I don't either, you can go online and do it. And this would be especially helpful if after a day or two you're still thinking about the play and you're ready to respond. Go online and let us know, because it's really useful to hear from you, and it's an important part of the process. So thank you so much for playing along. I want you to know that there will also be a talk back immediately following the play. So if you got a few minutes, again, hope you'll stick around for a second and have a little bit of a chat with us about your response to the play. There is one intermission in the play this evening, so during that time, we hope you'll go back there and spend some money on diabetes, getting some sugar. The concessions benefit goes to the professional internship program, so we hope that you'll spend some money on that. And
there's no intermission.
I'm embarrassed to show you right here where it says no intermission. Yeah, so don't do that. You can do that for the show, though. Or you can just leave a donation for the professional internship program. And nobody gets sick.
hour of silence. Just double check, turn them off, turn them all the way off. We always appreciate it if you don't do anything that includes using a lit screen, even if it's quiet, because sometimes that can also be distracting. So appreciate your being cognizant of that. Thank you so much for being here. Truly, we really, really couldn't be doing this kind of work without you, and we're really, really proud to be doing it. So we hope you're proud to be a part of it. So sit back and enjoy Pathogenesis with Jeremy Sony.
Pathogenesis by Jeremy Sony. The stage is dark. We hear the heavy creak of a metal hatch opening. With it, a shaft of light spills in, illuminating a metal staircase. Sebastian Riley, a professorial type in his late 50s, enters in a tuxedo. Parker, a 30-something man that looks like he should be delivering special reports on Nightline, follows. Sebastian flips a switch and lights flicker on. We're in a decommissioned fallout shelter. Remnants of its 1960s origin can be seen. Bunk beds now buried in books, the pantry now stocked with scientific lab supplies, an old table converted into a desk workstation surrounded by modern-looking equipment and monitors. They are mid-conversation.
The bloody biographer, you tell me. What does it say about a man's life's work if no one believes in it?
The Centers for Disease Control didn't say you were credible.
I didn't realize you were at those meetings.
My sources said you didn't present enough evidence to warrant action.
Duh. The evidence to warrant action is there. It's the action itself with which they take issue. The threat is real. There's a global killing virus out there. I've seen it. I could stop it. The CDC thinks it's contained, but it's creeping along, growing stronger, getting set to explode. And when it does, there will be nothing they can do.
They're the CDC.
And I'm Sebastian Ryan. You think I don't know what I'm talking about?
I've read your papers. Your predictions of viral evolutions are unprecedented.
Incredible, some might say.
Absolutely.
Impossible to believe. That's the definition of incredible. Not credible.
If I ticked you off bringing up the CDC, I'm not sorry.
No, you wouldn't be. You're the one who wants to stand on my back and write a book about it.
Look, I'm not gonna lie. Your recent feud with Atlanta is more than intriguing, but it's not the whole story. What about your early career theories? What about that Sebastian Riley, the one who studied under Caesar Milstein at Cambridge? Your work in vaccine development has gone a long way to saving a lot of people.
My recent theories have the potential to save even more.
Which is why I'm grateful that you finally agreed to meet with me. My sources are good, but they're not the horse's mouth. I just wish we had more time. I'm leaving for Phoenix in the morning to start a book tour.
Yes, I heard. Phoenix. Then on to Albuquerque, Denver, Kansas City. There's a lot of autographs and handshakes, isn't it?
It's another step. The right book about the right person would be another.
The clock still has a few ticks remaining before my evening engagement. I'd be curious what your sources told you.
My sources were discreet. Mm-hmm. So for you to take time to talk, especially here, Sebastian Riley's secret lair.
It's a lab.
Your lab, two key words in that sentence.
Did you come here to see if they were right?
Why are you so sensitive about that? They disagreed with you. Did you forget what that feels like?
Uh-huh.
You've got a couple of options on how to respond. First, prove them wrong. Until you can, it's helpful to put things in context for them. A biography, one that is authorized, can do exceptional things for how you're perceived.
Oh, God. Selling myself. Branding an image. To get people to believe in that which they cannot see, though it is right in front of them.
Look.
I feel a bit like God in that respect. Oh, I know that one. Are you the fearing type, Parker? Or do you simply believe in him?
Is that a problem?
No. It's compounding, given what I do, what I study.
You study life. There's a design to it.
I study organisms at the edge of life. Potentially destructive. Dangerous. It is chaos.
Have you ever thought that the design is not in the chaos, but in your ability to combat it? Dr. Milstein, as he accepted the Nobel Prize, said that although the way ahead is full of pitfalls and difficulties, this is indeed an exhilarating prospect. He held that belief because of his religion, because of his faith.
Science has little room for God.
It depends on the science.
Funny. I thought it depended on the God.
Look, maybe we should reschedule.
Well, I've offended you.
No.
If you're worried about detaining me, remember I invited you here tonight.
The university gala? Sounds like a hell of a party.
If by party you mean I get dolled up, paraded around the donors so the university can relieve them of the burden of their wealth, then yes, it's a hoot.
If you hate it that much, why not bail and let me pick your brain all night?
The Presidium Medal. The university's highest honor. Each year they select individuals that have made an impact on society.
And your daughter. She's coming home from Atlanta, right? From the CDC?
Yes, for the medal ceremony. She's the assistant chief of immunology and pathogenesis research. I'm to present her, the Presidium.
Having an inside woman at the CDC didn't earn you any points at those meetings?
Oh, I sent her several additional reports with regard to the virus and my proposed solution. We're meeting before the gala to discuss them.
So she's on board with it?
Do you know what Presidium means? It's Latin. It means protection or defense. It goes to those a university deems protectors.
They want to honor the work she does at the CDC?
Rewarding potential when they should be rewarding action. I know why they asked me, of all people, to make this introduction tonight.
You are Sebastian Riley, and she is pretty much Sebastian Riley Jr.
She prefers Catherine, last we spoke.
Last?
People stop speaking sometimes, Parker. It's not always both at the same time.
I thought you said she was coming to meet you.
I invited her to talk. She can be stubborn, just like her mother.
What did you do?
I didn't do anything. Her mother died.
Shit, I'm sorry.
Sebastian retrieves a bottle of whiskey from a nearby shelf, pours himself a glass.
Catherine wanted to talk about it. I was ensconced in my work, purposefully. By the time I was home for her, she had moved to Atlanta. I still often forget that Helen isn't up waiting for me. Hasn't even been a year, hence the whiskey.
You've seen Catherine, though, since then?
We communicate.
You send her reports?
Just don't talk.
Then why do you think she will back you in your fight with the CDC?
She won the Presidium, not only for her research, but for her nature to do what is right. As a scientist and a human being. I've never given my daughter an award she didn't earn. I'm confident in her support.
You're confident in a lot.
Yes. Helen teased me relentlessly about how I'm rubbish with people. And how Catherine is just like me, which she's not. Helen would have brought us together by force, if necessary.
Helen sounds like she was a smart woman.
She was my equilibrium.
Not a word most men use to describe their late wives?
Sebastian pours a second glass of whiskey, offering it to Parker.
I met Helen when she was living in Paris. I was on holiday from Cambridge, and I stumbled upon a bookshop on the left bank. She was there, giving a reading. I couldn't take my eyes off of her. I approached her afterward to chat her up.
And she said yes?
Every single interaction between two people is brimming with potential to change the world. Something is always shared, our thoughts, our words, a touch, a kiss, saliva, flecks of dead skin, hair, bacteria.
That's romantic.
We share a lot with each other. I wanted to share everything with her. I laid on all the moves any eager young pup could conjure. She smiled, leaned in, and asked me what she had just read. Didn't have a clue. Ever determined, I grinned and told her that I was too distracted by her beauty.
And that worked.
Oh, God, no, she laughed in my face. I told her it was a compliment. She said the real compliment would have been paying attention to her words. I grew up a little bit that night in Paris. But just not always in the ways I'd hoped. She never let me forget it. You need someone to balance you out in this world, Parker. Helen was my someone.
Parker raises his glass in salute.
To Helen.
Sebastian lifts his glass in return.
To equilibrium.
Catherine Riley, in her 30s and dressed in evening wear, appears at the hatch.
What are we toasting?
You. You're late.
I'm here, aren't I? Who's this?
I was worried. It was Roger, wasn't it? He's a bad influence on you.
Yes, you know how he's gotten me hooked on the crystal meth.
She's joking. Don't write that down.
I gathered I'm not. And I'm Parker, by the way. I'm working with your father.
Parker's doing some research on my work. We may be collaborating on a project.
We all make our own personal hell.
Sorry?
I'm sorry. I'm sure it will be a fascinating study, whatever it is. I thought, Dad, that you wanted to talk.
It's good alone. To see you too, Catherine. Drink.
She remains in the doorway. There's reserved love. Right now, very reserved.
If you wanted to hide from this, why did you invite me here to talk?
Why would you think I'm hiding?
That's what the purpose of this structure actually is, to hide within.
No, it's to shield and protect. There's a vast difference.
Where else would he invite you if not here?
He has a lab, a real one, at the university.
There's nothing wrong with a scientist having a home lab.
The samples you work with, the work you do, taking any of that from your labs on campus is irresponsible, dangerous, and I'm going to go with illegal. And this isn't your home.
It's close enough. It's under it, in the proximity.
It's a fallout shelter.
Formerly a fallout shelter, not really serving any active purpose on that front, which is good.
Why are you down here?
Finalizing my speech. This place has always helped me focus.
And the whiskey? Does that help you focus?
Only when the muse is reticent.
This speech should not be that difficult for you.
His speech is coming along. You're going to love those words that... He's writing?
That he's writing? Okay. I came here to speak with my father. When I need you to blunder an answer for him, I'll give you a signal.
You don't need to be such a brat.
I don't need to be such a brat. I don't need to be here at all. Roger convinced me that it would be the right thing to do, the honorable, dutiful daughter thing to do.
Oh, I'll have to thank him.
He's flying in right now, on his way to Tokyo. He'll meet me at the gala, and he won't have time to talk to you.
Ooh, shame.
I came here because you said you wanted to talk about Mom. You needed to talk about her. So I think, hey, that's good because he's been obsessing over his work since she died, and maybe he's finally ready to deal with it, to deal with me, because tonight's a big deal, and she's not here. Maybe he realizes that. Maybe he's actually reaching out, finally. So the benefit of the doubt is bestowed upon you, and look what you do with it.
I'm sorry I called you a brat.
Are you? Were you even planning on coming tonight?
Chancellor Fredericks insisted.
Nerd, she knows how you hate these events.
Does one even know the right words to say to open a wallet?
They opened their wallets to get in the door, not because you're standing up there on that stage like some academic busker. Oh, but then you're right. You're right. That's what this evening
I
is all about.
There.
You always say that, but there's always something more pressing.
This is different.
Yeah, you always say that, too.
Did you get the follow-up reports I sent to you about the Belgium incident? My recommendations to the CDC?
You want to talk about Belgium?
I invited you here in hopes we could speak as colleagues.
Colleagues? All right. What do colleagues say to one another at these events? Oh, it's a gala. I know. Small talk. Your tuxedo, black tie, you nailed it.
You're evading the question.
She complimented your tuxedo. You're not going to say anything about her dress?
The dress is flattering, surprisingly.
Well, I do like to surprise you.
She's your daughter, and she looks beautiful. It's not an achievement. It's a state of being. You can acknowledge it.
You look like a mother.
Parker, Are you joining us for the gala?
No, I wasn't invited to this reunion.
Well, we can't all be so lucky. Mom wouldn't like that you're drinking down here.
But we need to talk about Belgium. You didn't read the reports, did you?
I read the first one. I read some of the second one. I opened the third one, and by then I realized you had no intention
Catherine,
of actually addressing the issue important to you. We haven't spoken directly in months.
I've been traveling.
From Belgium to Kiev to Hong Kong. Oh, I even heard you were in Melbourne.
I was in Atlanta.
Not for me.
Pumpkin.
I think I should go.
That's what you want. We can meet after the gala, then.
I'm leaving. For the UN summit?
Oh, the summit, right. Tomorrow.
I'm taking the red eye from New York tonight.
Then surely 5 minutes for your father won't kill you.
I don't know. Will it?
She would have been proud of you tonight.
Of that, I have no doubt.
I miss her, too. What have your superiors told you about Belgium?
No, we're talking about the outbreak 8 months ago.
It's all right. Parker's working with me, remember?
A potential new strain of influenza. Why are you asking me? You were there, I know, because you weren't here.
You clearly don't understand why I was there.
You weren't there for us.
Of all the necessary pursuits we study as scientists, in our research, in life, what is the only thing we can all agree on?
Do you spend down here now?
You said 5 minutes. This is what I want to talk about.
Answer the question.
I like it here. Answer mine.
That's not an answer.
Survival. It's all about survival. Ever since your mum died, the two of you aren't around anymore in the house. Well.
You like it here better.
No, I hate it, actually. I'm surviving. I liked it there. But there is... Well, that's all right to hell, too, isn't it?
Do you want me to say I'm sorry?
You left as things were about to get interesting.
My mother died. I'd had about all I could take of interesting.
Well, that explains why you moved to Atlanta. Moved in with Roger.
Didn't I tell you we all make our own personal hell?
You had a life.
I have a life.
At the university. Teaching, researching, publishing.
And now I have one at the CDC. Researching, discovering, thriving in Atlanta with Roger.
It's good to see we're both surviving.
Yes.
Seems to be the only thing you both agree on.
Survival is the most necessary of pursuits. To ensure the continuation of you, me, Catherine, here, requires observation of the mundane, of the chaos, of everything.
Observation or obsessing?
Oh, this isn't obsessing.
This would piss her off. And yes, this is you obsessing. You got all dressed up and then what, came down here to fixate on overinflated theories and drag me along?
I had little choice. You sided with the CDC.
I am the CDC now. And for the record, I didn't side against you. The CDC didn't side against
they
you.
They rebuked my proposal.
No, they carefully considered your proposal, and it was too radical.
This potential new strain isn't a potential. It's happening. I hope that you, of all people at the CDC, would piece it together if I laid it out in front of it.
I wasn't at those meetings.
What did they find radical about his proposal?
You're working with him. Tell me, what other option did the CDC have?
I don't work at the CDC, so I would know. What I do know is that your father made a name for himself in charting viral evolution.
It wasn't his predictions about the virus that raised alarm. It was his cure.
He told me he knows how to stop it, not cure it.
Prevention is often the best cure.
Like a vaccine.
Except he probably neglected to tell you that his vaccine comes at a cost.
The flu pandemic of 1918. How many people did it kill?
We're talking about an isolated outbreak in Belgium, not the Spanish flu. If you want to lecture history, call up some of your students.
No, this is about context. Many pathogens show protein markers dating back to the earliest forms of life. Viruses have walked this planet longer than we have. We need to respect them. What we're seeing now, we've seen before.
Half the men we sent over to fight in World War I were struck down by the Spanish flu before even a bullet could find them. Are you saying that this Belgium virus is related?
And that they both originated as a mutation, as an evolution of alien flu? And that they both have the ability to cause hypercytokinemia in their victims? Then yes. Except what we saw in Belgium. 1918 looked like a chest cold.
A hypercytokinemia.
You haven't studied this? Cytokine cascade, also known as the cytokine storm. In your immune system, the cytokines in the body signal the attack on any invading pathogen. They charge in there and they go to work. They multiply in order to keep up the attack, like sending in reinforcements, until the threat is contained.
Exactly, except the Spanish flu was a highly aggressive strain because of its evolution from avian flu. It sent out signals to the cytokines, which switched off their ability to self-regulate. Thus, they kept sending reinforcements.
The attack inside the body never stops. Eventually, the pathogen is destroyed, but the cytokines keep going, and the attack spreads to healthy organs, one after another, until they begin to shut down. It's a cascade effect. If that doesn't kill you, you're so weak that the secondary infections run rampant.
Ironically, the stronger the immune system, the more devastating the effect.
Yes, it can be.
Yeah, that's why so many victims of the Spanish flu were otherwise healthy adults.
No wonder the government tried to cover it up at the time. We were in the middle of World War I, and they wanted to keep up morale here at home. So at first, they didn't report how many people in Allied countries were dying. Both sides kept that information from the public. With Spain being neutral, they were the only ones sending out reports of the devastation. Hence, the Spanish flu. But, morale aside, the existence of this cytokine storm could have caused even more panic. We didn't want to frighten our own people. Unless we're the ones who took that thing over there in the first place.
You think the Spanish flu was a failed attempt at biological warfare?
Hypercytokinemia has never been weaponized. I think what Parker is inferring is that the Spanish flu started quite innocuously in a few soldiers at an army training base in Kansas. It simply preferred the strong type.
If this Belgium thing is exhibiting the same markers...
It exhibited traits frighteningly similar. Clear indicators of avian flu, but also other strains. It will be far more virulent, farther-reaching, and worst case, 90%. Not infectivity, not severity, morbidity. Over 6 billion people dead.
Worst case. Belgium was isolated.
Kiev! Hong Kong, Melbourne, does that sound isolated?
There were no related outbreaks in those cities.
But there were outbreaks reported. Kiev, H1N1, Hong Kong, H5N1, swine flu, bird flu, Melbourne, the same.
These were all brush fires, identified flu strains, all of them.
It wouldn't be the first time a new flu strain has been misidentified. Before they figured it out, Spanish flu was thought to be cholera or typhoid.
I think our methods of identification have improved slightly since then. Additionally, cytokine cascades have not been verified in the Belgium cases.
Ah, but have they been ruled out? In 1918, one soldier in Kansas infected with avian flu infected his belt, infected his regiment, and a brush fire became a firestorm. These outbreaks over the past year, they're all connected to Belgium. If you don't believe me, pull the reports. I presume you have the credentials.
You want me to hack into the CDC.
I'm certain it's all right there. The signs, the patterns.
The patterns? Are you gonna point to bird migration, ecological fluctuations? Oh, is this about the bees again? You cannot tie colony collapse to these flu outbreaks.
Something is killing the bees. I'd be curious to know what.
Let an entomologist figure it out.
These influenza strains fit the patterns I've been predicting. If you dig deep at the CDC, you'll see that I'm not wrong.
Or maybe they fit them because you're looking for patterns in the chaos, traveling about the world, chasing ghosts. This is being handled.
Oh, by whom? The CDC? How are they supposed to handle this? It was already beyond them, beyond the World Health Organization 8 months ago in Belgium.
Jesus, this is why you weren't there for her.
I went to Belgium because they needed my help.
They could have sent anyone. They didn't need the great Sebastian Riley.
Yes, they did. They do. This flu is vicious. We need to push out a vaccine.
This global killer virus is your white whale, and I am not going down with your ship.
My white whale. So there it is. What you think of me. Of my work, my research, the ravings of an old man.
You're not raving.
Yet you don't believe me. Catherine, I taught you. Bought you your very first lab kit, first microscope, and still, you weren't in Belgium. You didn't see firsthand what it can do.
I wasn't in Belgium because I was with Mom. She was dying.
She wasn't supposed to die.
And you weren't supposed to go. And now you're fixated on this Belgian flu because I guess it gives you something to fight. Is that it? Is that it? Is that your way of apologizing to her, to me, for leaving? Are you even sorry?
I'm not apologizing. I'm trying to fix it.
You don't have to. Mom isn't something you can fix anymore.
I'm not talking about your mother.
That is the problem. You have given yourself something to fight because you're afraid to face what happened to her, creating theories on how to stop this oncoming storm. But did you ever stop to think that maybe people like me, people at the CDC, are working on ways to prevent this pandemic?
People like you, yes, but not you specifically. Studying away and running the test, and they figured it out. Would you whisper to me behind their backs if they did? The CDC was keen to want my help until I presented a solution that didn't live up to their standards and practices. My proposal was sound.
Sebastian goes to a shelf and retrieves a metallic container about the size of a portable cooler.
It's all about survival. This is a dangerous world, and through studying it, I found the safest path through it.
He sets the container on the table.
What is that?
How do you vaccinate the entire planet before the virus spreads?
You create vaccines and administer them. There are procedures to follow. Are you going to answer his question?
With a morbidity rate that high, infection would be rapid and nearly absolute. There's no way to reach everyone.
You could start with urban centers, inoculate the most vulnerable, try to create herd immunity.
Except herd immunity is tenuous. It leaves the population at risk.
There's always risk.
And why is that?
Influenza strains are dangerous because they frequently mutate. They evolve.
So the vaccines must evolve as well. Fight fire with fire. We need something that will spread quickly, reach everyone. Get into the nooks and crannies of society where the healthcare providers and syringes cannot go.
You engineered a vaccine.
The weakest strain of the global killer. Released and allowed to run its course.
Released?
Aerosolized like the flu. An airborne vaccine spread on droplets of saliva and fluids, careening about us through wayward sneezes and open coughs.
Like a virus. I didn't think you would actually synthesize it.
It was shockingly simple. Once I figured out that not only did the makeup of the vaccine need to evolve, but the delivery system as well. Studying the virus, watching it adapt each outbreak stretching its reach just a bit further, getting closer to the tipping point when we won't be able to contain it. It's going to happen fast. We have to be faster. Direct contact followed by infection. We have to adapt. It was so obvious.
Parker, we need to leave.
The best delivery system we have is ourselves.
Sebastian unseals the container, cracking open the lid. A cool mist spills over from the inside. Parker and Catherine both step back.
In fact, a small sample of the population, ideally with the hope that they would geographically disseminate the pathogenic vaccine, like the boys from Kansas.
You're proposing we create one pandemic to stop another?
Give the planet a lighter version of the Belgium flu? That's what's in there?
Precisely. Where the bigger beast rears its head, and it will. Within 6 months, I guarantee you that. You will have nothing to consume. We will have our immunity. We will survive.
And your viral vaccine? How many people?
It would save billions.
How many die? I know you've run the numbers.
5. Maybe 10%. But when you weigh that against the alternative...
5%? That's like the population of the United States.
It wouldn't be localized to the United States once it's been aerosolized.
So it's not yet.
They won't know. I told you. The delivery mechanism is us. I created cocktails, if you will. It'll be like taking your cold medicine.
Cold medicine that makes us walking plague victims.
You feel a bit ill for a few days. I'll give you proper meds to get you back around on the mend. However, yes, you would be extremely contagious with a pathogenic vaccine. Ideally, you would infect every person you came in contact with, and they, in turn, would do the same.
Except they won't get a med supply when we infect them. I'm a little surprised the CDC didn't think this warranted action.
They never thought he was crazy enough to actually attempt it. There is nothing you can say that will make me think this is a viable option.
We're talking globally, Catherine. 300 million people's lives against 7 billion.
20 million lives against 7 billion. 1 million lives, 500,000. The number of people in the sacrificial lamb column is irrelevant if it's more than one.
The entire human race is on the verge of extinction.
That doesn't mean we help it along. I wasn't in those meetings in Atlanta because they thought that being your daughter, I might have a conflict of interest when it came to a decision as to whether or not to pursue your recommendations. They were right. We have a conflict of interest. You said you wanted to talk about Mom luring me down here with that nugget of hope, a plea for help, you said. This plea for help is what? You want me to go back to the CDC and tell them I had a heart-to-heart with dear old dad that whatever contingency plan we're cooking up in case Belgium wasn't isolated is doomed to fail? Is that what you want?
No. What I want is for you to understand. Do you think I honestly came to something like this lightly? I'm not a monster, Catherine. I don't relish the idea of anyone dying, not in my hand. What I want is to know that I'm right.
I don't know how I can give you that peace of mind.
You can start by giving me your CDC access codes.
Parker approaches the container to inspect it.
What? I wouldn't touch that if I were you.
It's not aerosolized.
Why do you need my access codes?
It's fine, as long as we don't ingest it.
Or touch it. If that's what he claims it is, if that's anything related to Belgium, it has the potential to be extremely devastating.
It has the potential to be substantially more.
Look at it. Do all vaccines look like this? I mean, it's almost simple, innocent.
It's almost beautiful. Did you know the term vaccine derives from an actual virus?
Variole vaccinae. Huh? Cowpox in the vernacular.
Must have been astonishing. 1798, your Edward Jenner, the father of the first vaccine, proving that one virus can fight off another. In that case, smallpox.
Wouldn't romanticize him. He also killed the first person he injected. Do you understand what you have done?
What is it that you think I've done?
Created a biological agent on American soil.
Not if it's actually a cure.
You understand that I'm obligated to call this in to the CDC.
You would be excited. I thought perhaps you would see how I'm trying to help.
Help who?
You. All of us, ultimately, but mainly you. Oh, but fine. Call it in. Report your father. A biological agent, especially in the hands of a foreign national? Oh. I'm certain that will do wonders for your career at the CDC to have a terrorist in the family.
I'm going to ask you one more time. And if you don't tell me the truth, I'm going to walk out of here and make that call.
Truth. On my life.
Why do you need access to the CDC mainframe?
I need your CDC access code. I can download your mother's file.
Why? What will that prove?
The Belgian flu is the bug that killed your mother.
Catherine slaps Sebastian.
I can't believe that you would use her, that you would drag her into this!
Are you going to hear me out?
She is not a part of this.
Oh, she is. She always has been.
Parker, walk away. I don't think my father would appreciate an audience after I get through with him.
No, he stays. We all stay. Catherine, I know this is difficult to hear. She died of the flu.
A seasonal flu. Surprisingly virulent, I will grant you, but she was here in California, not Belgium, half a world away from whatever
pathogen took down that village.
They took down the whole village? Reports were that it was quarantined, 300 people.
And the outbreak was swift, extremely deadly, and had the village of Durvonis not been remote, it would have spread.
They were a trading post.
Were they? Durvonis was the base of a smuggling operation, which meant they valued privacy. Blessing in disguise. The avian flu came in through smuggled eagles. The next shipment was contained at the Brussels airport in quarantine, but an infected shipment had already reached the village.
There was nothing about infected eagles in the public record.
And the man, patient zero, was a handler. He was already dead when I arrived.
Reports are that his wife was also dead.
Yes, but she reported they had no contact with the eagles.
So a severe case of avian flu mutates to become infectious between humans.
Well, that was a preliminary finding. However, in examining the tissue of the victims, there was an unidentified strain.
How many victims?
The situation was contained. The few survivors were relocated and the town was sealed off. That was 8 months ago.
She was diagnosed. You were there for that part. You saw it.
Yes, and that's why I thought it safe to leave her with you. The only other person qualified to look after her.
I'm sorry, but if Helen died in California while you were in Belgium, how would she contract this thing?
Because I don't believe it started in Belgium.
I need to leave.
Catherine, please.
I know you think that you're doing right by her, but you're not. I came here because I thought I could help you. But you are inventing shadows, and I want no part of it.
Catherine moves to the exit.
Maybe it's best if you stay here with Parker, because it's clear that you were never going to let tonight be about me. These past 8 months, since we lost Mom, you've changed. You've become unstable. I don't know how to talk to you like this, how I'm supposed to stand here and listen to theories and scenarios that strain credibility.
Does the fact that he's your dad buy him any credit with you?
Once upon a time, it would have bought him everything.
And now?
Parker, I know you mean well, but this situation is extremely complicated.
Yes, we should simplify it.
They look to see Sebastian has pulled a glass vial from the container.
If I can't convince you to help me for your mother's sake, perhaps I can convince you to help me for my own.
Dad
opens the vial.
Put that down.
Organisms at the edge of life. So infinitesimal, yet so powerful.
Dad, please. You're scaring me.
Good. Then maybe that means you actually believe me now.
Sebastian downs the liquid from the vial. He takes a breath, caps the now empty vial, and sets it back into the container. Nobody moves for a moment. Catherine and Parker aren't sure what to do.
Let's hope I don't follow too closely in Edward Jenner's footsteps.
Be happening. I don't want to believe that this is happening. No daughter wants to believe that her father is capable of cruelty on this scale.
Cruelty and mercy dance along a fine line together, Catherine.
I know. The Chancellor put you up to this, didn't she? This is some sort of Presidium Medal initiation, or better yet, my father didn't know how to talk to me, to how to apologize for Belgium, so he created a scenario so absurd that I'd have to laugh. That's why you agreed to present my award, so I'd meet with you.
You asked your own daughter here so you could infect her, infect me?
Not infect, Parker. I'm offering a cure.
We're not sick!
We could be now!
I'm trying to save you. Save us.
Look, I'm trying to see this from your angle.
His angle is him! Haven't you picked up on that? Even when the night isn't about him, he finds a way to keep the world in his solipsistic little orbit.
This Presidium Medal actually means something to you, doesn't it?
Of course it does. How does that escape you?
We haven't exactly been priorities in one another's lives.
How exactly did you think this would play out tonight?
You would bow to logic and reason as any daughter of mine would.
Oh, it would be nice if I wasn't your daughter, only when it suited you to have one.
I'm sorry I had to resort to more drastic measures. This seemed the only effective way to connect with you. I need your help.
I need... Dad, do you hear yourself? How do you justify putting me in this position tonight? Of all nights! nights, actually, you know, any night. Why would you do that? I came here tonight because I thought perhaps my father wanted to talk to his daughter about her, about them. I thought perhaps some miracle had occurred and that for once since my mother died, I might actually have a conversation with my father that wouldn't drive me insane because for some reason beyond any logic that I can muster, I still actually give a shit about him.
You don't seem very happy about that.
You know... Taking part in tonight was that tough. You could have just said, oh, Catherine, I don't see the bloody point of this bloody
don't
big
talk
ball.
Like that.
Oh, well, tell the bloody Chancellor she can bloody well piss off.
The Chancellor can't piss off. She's parading me in front of the donors, prostituting me and my good name for the university's benefit.
She's not parading you!
Can we all just take a step back?
This is my university. They respect me.
They respect you? This speech you've been working on, does it even reference me or my work? If they could see you tinkering away in this little hovel amid the debris, that is your career.
I am a great scientist.
You are an ass sometimes.
If I'm an ass, what does that make the Chancellor?
Oh, I don't know. I guess she's just an idiot who thought that the great Sebastian Riley might enjoy presenting his own daughter with the Presidium Medal. You're selfish. You can't stand that I am the Dr. Riley, whose name they'll call tonight, and you'll be the one who has to watch me take that award back to Atlanta to continue my work without you. But you didn't even start writing a fucking speech.
Would you two stop it? There's a bigger picture to look at here. I'm not as mind-altering intelligent as the two of you, but I'm pretty sure what he just took isn't a good thing. Or maybe it's the best thing in the whole world. Either way, maybe we could address that.
We are.
Sounds to me like one of you is having a hissy fit and the other doesn't know how to handle it.
He ruined my night. Oh, Chancellor Fredericks is going to be livid about this.
I am not afraid of Bianca Fredericks.
She's like the queen of the university, not the person to piss off, especially on a night like this, her big gala. You don't poke that bear.
What does this all have to do with her?
Okay, you want to address it? That vial, the vaccine, the virus, you're right. It isn't a good thing. Whatever my cunning father ingested, it's an unknown, potentially hazardous bioagent. We are not going to the gala.
Catherine walks over to the hatch and closes it, sealing them inside.
We are now under quarantine.
Under whose authority?
Mine.
We can't be quarantined.
Actually, it's not that hard. We just don't leave. We don't get to. Not until we are clear.
I have places to be tomorrow. And the day after that, and so on.
We all do.
Some of us tonight. What were you thinking? Honestly, I would love to know.
Anyone who takes on this field of work knows there are choices that you won't have time to think about. Can you simply make and live, choices you simply make and live with the repercussions?
You had time to think. You made yourself a human trial for an untested vaccine. The CDC runs tests and does years of research before a vaccine even goes near a person.
We don't have years.
Oh, yeah, we don't have to be reckless then. It could kill you, Dad. You could die.
I'm fine.
For now. All right. You, over there. Parker, you're with me.
Am I being isolated?
We have an isolation chamber. Or even a tarp.
I'm not contagious yet.
Forgive me if I don't believe you 100% right now.
I'm sorry, but the situation has upset you. But you're the only one placing the quarantine, so it's impeding on your evening.
I am not upset about the quarantine. I can handle a quarantine. I'm a big girl. I'm upset because you knew I would do this. You knew I would follow procedure.
Huh. You're not following every procedure.
If this turns out to be as vicious as I think it might, I'm going to have the CDC up your ass so far before you can even think about questioning my procedure again. I should have called for help the moment I realized what you had done. You know, it's easy, usually, to know right from wrong. It's harder when those distinctions have to be made with family.
So what do we do now?
Do you believe in God?
Do you?
My mother did. She always prayed for me. For him, too. I don't know how many
much of it stuck, but I liked the feeling of security it gave me.
Then I'll pray for you. And Dr. Riley.
A kind but futile gesture.
No one's unredeemable.
I'm holding on to the slightest hope that I can reverse whatever he's done.
You can do that?
Well, we're going to find out. He knew that I'd have to test him as well as test the unidentified agent to determine what we're dealing with.
You know what you're dealing with.
Presuming my father did, in fact, cultivate that vaccine from cultures or samples stolen from Belgium.
Obtained in the field. The CDC does not hold the patent on naturally mutating viruses appearing in the wild, especially on another continent.
He claims that he engineered this vaccine as a pathogen, and if it does what he says it does, if the type of flu it produces is highly communicable and potentially deadly...
Then that means that he probably designed it off some nasty pieces of work.
It should have trace elements and other indicators that identify it at least among strains in the avian flu families. You knew that once I couldn't identify a standard strain of flu, that I would have to test them against the samples we have on file and the records on Belgium.
He drank that not to keep you here, but to force you to access your files remotely.
I was always going to drink it, if doing so encourages young Dr. Riley to puzzle out the truth and see my side of things. That's a happy circumstance.
You also realize that she could prove that you're a bioterrorist.
Well then, we better get started.
I taught you to test every hypothesis. Run every scenario. I won't stop you. Test every vial in that container, if you like. Once you have the evidence in front of you, I'm confident you will know the correct course of action.
I'm going to be clear about this. The only records I will be pulling will be in relation to Belgium and confirming the contents of that container. Mom's records are sealed as far as we're concerned.
You do what you see is right. That's all I ask.
Catherine goes to a computer terminal to access the files she needs. A series of large monitors flicker to life as the system boots up. Some of these screens are for displaying records and standard computer files. Some other screens are tied into the equipment in the room and used similarly to a high-powered microscope. Catherine begins going through drawers and cupboards, pulling out gloves and a safety face shield.
Parker, I need you to suit up too.
She pulls on a lab coat.
I'd advise at least goggles or a face shield, and maybe a lab coat if you care about your clothes.
Catherine goes to a drawer and finds a syringe.
What's the needle for?
Him. Seasonal flu viruses attack respiratory and digestive tract cells generally. Avian flu is more vicious. It thrives attacking our blood cells.
Like a little vampire virus.
It starts like a flu, hitting the respiratory lining, but then it seeps from there into the bloodstream. It likes it there. It teams up with the cytokines and it goes to town.
She tosses him some gloves and puts on a pair of her own.
Put these on. You might want to double up to draw his blood. With some alacrity would be nice.
About that.
Catherine, now in full lab mode, puts the syringe by Parker and moves over to the container. She carefully picks up the vial Sebastian emptied.
Parker is not going to take my blood, in case you're wondering.
Don't fight him on it. And you, don't let my dad intimidate you. You've got this.
Actually, no, I don't. It probably helps to know how to draw blood to draw blood. I mean, I could cut him or stab him with this needle, but that's not what you're suggesting, is it?
What kind of virologist are you?
I'm not. Why would you make that assumption?
You're working with my father. You seem to know quite a bit about pathogens. You said he's working with you.
I am.
He's just not a scientist. He's a writer.
Catherine moves the vial over to a workstation and preps the contents of the vial for analysis.
Oh, he hired you to write the speech. Should I call you Parker, the reticent muse? I will love those words. That he's writing. Oh, how did I not get that?
Because it's not what I meant.
I'm not entirely surprised. If Mom were alive, he'd turn to her for help. Mm,
she was far better with words.
He's fine with words when he wants to be. He just has no respect for the award. Why should he have any respect for the recipient?
There's respect.
Huh. Maybe not for the trinket, but I think it's clear that he respects you.
Which part of tonight led you to this conclusion? It's a fascinating hypothesis.
He left you.
That's a counterpoint.
No, he left you with her. When he went to Belgium, I don't think he would have left if you hadn't been there.
Catherine stops.
You're suggesting that it's my fault he wasn't there for my mother when she died?
No, I'm suggesting he trusted you with her. With her recovery.
Oh, I see. So, it's not my fault he wasn't there. It's my fault she died?
All I am trying to say is that from the time I've had to observe your father, his actions from the point of your mother's death until tonight show that, in his way, he respects you. He trusts you.
What do you mean, observe?
That's what I do for a living. I observe. I analyze. I report my findings.
Sound like a scientist.
He's a journalist.
Are you kidding me? You brought press to this? Here, into your lab with whatever you just ingested. You thought it would be a good idea to put it on the news. Oh my God, are you trying to create a panic?
He's trying to tell his story.
Did you put him up to this?
Observer.
Oh. Don't give me that documentarian line of crap. You need a story to tell, and you've decided to exploit my father and his theories.
He's not exploiting, Catherine. Parker would very much like to pen my biography.
Oh, well, then that makes everything okay. You tell me, when did he show up?
Why is that relevant?
Was it a year ago? When he was a renowned scientist leading one of the most prestigious immunology doctoral programs in the United States? No. He showed up now. After my mother died. After he chose to do this. After he decided that it was worth risking years of work and reputation, that all that could be cast aside for some ill-fated attempt at being the savior of the world that I'm pretty certain will end with him being a laughingstock. Because I'm at the scene. Hear how they talk about him, how they pity him, how they don't understand how a mind as brilliant as his could rationalize the slaughtering of millions, given the chance.
They acknowledge the threat, though.
I am not going on the record with you.
Do you see a notebook or a recording device?
He's got a point.
Off the record, it's just us, the three of us, isolated from everyone up there, all the naysayers, all the suits at the CDC, between you and me, do they believe the threat will spread beyond Belgium? No comment. All right. But you should know that no comment is like a flare gun. Where you look for evidence to prove a hypothesis, so do journalists. We hypothesize, we theorize, we observe. See, I think they believe the threat has legs. What do you think? Maybe they get the threat, but they don't yet know how to fight it. And when your father presented them with an option, they panicked. Not because it was radical or dangerous, but because it might be the actual solution, and they're just panic-stricken that he might be the one who's figured it all out.
Well, now you're just writing sensationalist fiction.
From an observational standpoint, the way you suited up, face shield, and all the riot gear, I'll just answer for you. Yeah, they do. And so do you.
I am being cautious and following procedure.
And I applaud you for that. But me? I'm being attentive, because there's something that could kill me in this bunker. You'll forgive me if I'd like to have all the facts.
It is going to kill you in here, Parker. It's out there, I'd worry, though.
Dr. Riley, what happens if we do absolutely nothing? Or what happens if the CDC tries the old-fashioned way to stop this thing? I'm talking to either of you.
Neither course of action is particularly pleasant, but the slaughter of millions, as she coined it, is the lesser of two evils, I assure you.
Evil being the operative term.
And now I'm being evil. If before. I was just being a bad father and a laughing stock. How quickly opinion shifts when one is trying to be necessary.
You are becoming self-destructive.
That's what happens when you lose your equilibrium. God doesn't put evil people into the world. Evil's there, and we come along and pick it up and play with it. Sometimes too much. We know we shouldn't, but it's there, and unless there's an opposite force in your life, be it God or reason or whatever brings you balance, it'll take over.
People make their own choices, Parker. It's their nature that determines them.
For someone who spends her life studying people, you don't understand them.
I don't study people. It's what you do, apparently. I study the organisms that kill people.
Then let's study them. Together. I can't unhear this conversation. I'd like to leave, but I'm under quarantine, so that seems like something you'd probably be against. Run your tests.
Then what happens?
You decide if we're clear to go.
Catherine takes the syringe and goes back to the workstation.
You should probably wear those gloves and some of that protective gear anyway, until we know, for sure. And sit there and don't move. Don't touch anything. You don't want to get any of this stuff on you.
She gets the sample from the vial, now prepped for inspection, and places it in one of the lab machines.
What's that going to do?
Yeah. It's like a microscope, only more powerful than those wands you probably had as a kid in elementary science.
In a few minutes, it'll let me look at the protein codes, and I'll have something to compare to the CDC reports.
Can I help you pull those up?
No, I'll pull them up after I deal with him. Roll up your sleeve, Dad.
Why do you need to test him?
I need to see how present it is in his bloodstream, how quickly it's attacking him. It'll help me predict how soon he becomes contagious.
So I've done the calculations. You don't trust me?
You taught me to test every theory. Roll up your sleeve. That's a direct order from the CDC.
Oh, you're pulling rank? We're in my lab, and you're my daughter.
Neither gives you a controlling stake in how I conduct my research.
I know what I'm doing.
Then this blood test will confirm that you are right, as usual.
The sign of good faith.
Sebastian rolls up his sleeve and extends his arm to Catherine to begin a blood draw.
You know, I could walk him through this, or do it myself even, allow you to focus on other matters.
I'm going to focus on this right now, thank you.
Like your mother was, you are.
Tenacious.
Delightful, yet assertive.
She always found a way to see the best in people, to see you at your very best, even if you were at your very worst. I'm not like her. St. Helen.
I know from the flu.
She was on a retreat.
I have a needle in your arm.
She won't discuss it. I know what happened anyway.
It was a writing weekend. She did that. She was a writer. Helen Owens. Historical fiction?
Sorry, I tend to stick with the non-fictional present.
She wrote with her own style.
It was a poetry, too.
Mom was at Yosemite, one of her favorite places. She was writing this story about falling embers. But
she was writing about cannibals.
Yes, but the meaning was set in the image of the firefall.
She was writing about a family that became trapped on Glacier Point in a blizzard in the mid-1800s. Only one thing to do in a situation like that.
Glacier Point is a cliff face in Yosemite. It's got a 3,000-foot drop. High elevation. So the story was that this family ventures there, and after they become trapped by the snow and ice, every night they build a fire to keep warm. And every night they hope somebody's going to see it, but they're so high up that they're just there all alone. And eventually the food runs out. But they keep the fire going. One by one, their group dies of exposure, starvation, grief. For the ones left standing, survival is the only goal, no matter the cost. Survival is more powerful an urge than we sometimes realize. Well, eventually, waiting for someone to die was no longer an option. So when democracy fails, a knife does the trick. When the last man runs out of everything and the blizzard shows no sign of relenting, he kicks his fire over the side of the cliff in frustration, and then he lays down to rest.
2 days later, another camp in the valley hadn't been able to see the small fire on top of the cliff, but when he kicked it, the fire spilled over and the embers rained down in a cascade to the valley below. You could see it for miles. It was a waterfall of fire. The one thing that they thought was protecting them and keeping them warm was all along their salvation. They just approached it from the wrong angle.
I can see why she wrote about it.
Mm. Well, this was close to 8 months ago. There was... It's almost absurd when you think about who her daughter is and who she's married to. There was an outbreak.
Mm, I read about that. The conspiracy hounds were touting it might be bird flu.
That was checked. It has to be. You're in the wild. There are animals that carry this stuff. But in the end, it wasn't. It was just the flu. Seasonal flus can mutate. Usually that time of year, they're weaker. They're different, but weaker. This one surprised us. Hit maybe a dozen people. She was just there to write a few chapters. Get away from us for a bit. My dad and I working together has never been the most serene type of situation.
You were at the university with him?
I was up for tenure.
Almost done.
So she gets sick, other people get sick, and we get a call. Funny thing is, we heard about it from the CDC before we heard about it from her. She didn't think it was anything to worry us over.
They were setting up quarantines on the patients infected and wanted to bring in some specialists, but nothing to worry over.
Procedure.
We were close, being here in Palo Alto, so we were called in to consult. Yosemite, they said. And I knew.
Not everyone dies from the flu, but hers exacerbated. Mm. She felt fine, she said, the day we arrived.
Well, she was fine the next day, too. Tired, she said. That's when I got the call for the Belgian consul.
That's when he left. 2 days later, her vitals were erratic. She couldn't breathe as well as she had been. And then it was like someone reached in and just tipped a domino inside her. Her organs began shutting down. Your body depends on itself for each part to function, and so when one piece of the system fails you, the whole thing crashes.
Why didn't you come back?
I couldn't leave.
9 days total. She was in isolation. They wouldn't even let me see her without a suit, without all the riot gear. 9 days. Writing, smiling, coughing, gasping, probably praying, doctors working to save her, me trying desperately to help them, to help her, to reach him half a world away while she lay dying, alone. 9 days, and then she was gone. We tried everything, and in the end, I just wanted to kick fire over a cliff and lay down and rest with her.
I'm sorry.
Catherine has the blood she needs. She goes back to the machine terminals. Sebastian bandages his arm.
You didn't need to recall all of that.
I'm just stating what happened. He needed to hear it too.
She takes his vial of blood and pulls some to test in a second machine.
Your first sample from the vial is probably ready.
I know.
She goes back to the first machine, punches some buttons, and a display comes up. An extreme close-up of a virus.
Is that it?
Yeah.
Isn't that just Christ on a bicycle?
Is it? On a bicycle? Because if that's how the second coming begins, then God has a strange sense of humor.
All that is in this container? It's amazing.
Thank you.
You realize how small all that actually is.
It's like dozens of tiny galaxies. It's small universes themselves swirling about each other.
That's one way to look at it.
You don't see it? It's dense in the middle where they cluster and then radiating out. It's like the eye of God.
It certainly has the potential to bring his wrath.
So then you can tell what it is?
No, but something that perfect isn't natural. Nature is chaos, and that it's too exquisite to be chaos. I need to pull up the CDC file.
Parker goes over to Sebastian.
That's your baby, isn't it?
She's beautiful. I'm glad you see that. I like a bit about the galaxies. Not by intent, but I can see it now that you say it.
So 9 days.
What?
Your dad, he has what, 9 days? I mean, if this baby virus is built to mimic its daddy, then shouldn't it operate along the same timeline?
8 to 10, if left untreated. I'll be infectious in about 12 hours. For a few days, I'll be contagious to anyone I'm near enough to cough, sneeze, or touch.
Saliva, flecks of dead skin, all that.
Catherine goes back to machine number 2, where she's analyzing Sebastian's blood.
Based on Belgium, he should develop symptoms on day 3, but he'll soldier on, as so many of us do when we get a cold. It won't be until day 6 that he might need medical attention. By then, however, it would be too late.
Well, only too late if I'm a small part of the small percentage of overly susceptible people.
Your age puts you in that category.
Then it's probably a good thing that I will have antivirals handy on day 5 to swing the odds back into my favor.
So this baby virus, the vaccine, it's treatable?
No, there wouldn't be enough antiviral meds for the entire planet. It's the same problem with traditional vaccine delivery. We can't reach everyone. That, and most people won't seek treatment. It won't feel as severe as, say, Belgium. It'll seem almost benign, you know, innocent. It'll move slower inside you than Belgium, but still...
She stops, double-checks something on her monitor, clicks a few keys, and transfers the image to a larger screen.
What's wrong?
Dad, when you built this thing, what S1P receptor did you use?
I altered S1PR1 to inhibit the cytokine signals. It's the most effective way?
Efficient way to control the incubation period of the vaccine. I think you tapped into S1PR3.
Is that bad?
It's a different receptor. It has a different function. Are you quite certain?
You tell me, based on the rate of replication increased by the PR3 gene, I don't think your 12-hour contagion window will hold. I estimate you being symptomatic in 6 to 12 hours. You could be contagious in 3.
Well, that won't work.
But it's not a question of working. I don't think you get 8 to 10 days or even 5. I'd start antiviral much sooner. It's quicker than you predicted.
Oh, bollocks.
What did you expect was going to happen? You're playing with pathogens that you don't yet understand, and now you have made a mistake.
I don't make mistakes.
Sebastian, I think you did. It's going to be faster. If you're wanting a vaccine to get out there and spread through the population, isn't faster better?
No. If it moves too fast through the body, it'll either weaken itself or it'll kill the host too quickly.
Like the Spanish flu.
Exactly. It was highly virulent, but the outbreaks would burn through a population center fairly quickly. If it burns hot and bright, and then it fades out.
I'll have to move up my flight.
I'm not going anywhere.
I'm going to London. I was scheduled there later in the week. I need to fly out tomorrow morning. We should still be effective leaving for the UN summit tonight. We might even be catching at the end of the gala.
Holy shit.
Why are you going to London?
I've had an offer from Cambridge. An opportunity too good to waste. I'm flying out for interviews and to look at flats. I'm not certain what's left for me in Palo Alto.
I wasn't aware that you had a desire to return to England.
There's always a pull for anyone to return to their roots. Places that shape and mold you into the person you are rarely do so without leaving an impression in the clay. Besides, you have your life with Roger in Atlanta.
Never mind all that. I've got places to be.
I know, but like I've said, we're not going anywhere.
No. I mean, I'm leaving on a book tour in the morning. All week. Phoenix, Albuquerque, Denver, Kansas City. You're scheduled to fly to New York. The UN summit. Hey, Bass! When you agreed to meet me tonight, was there ever a chance of me writing your biography? Or was this all just a bait and switch to infect us and send us on an infectious disease tour?
This is why you agreed to present me with the Presidium?
Pumpkin, that's not why.
Oh, don't.
And Parker, you sought me out. This wasn't my master scheme. You presented an opportunity. I have every intention of having you write my biography. I'm just trying to give you a better story.
You're making me part of the story.
The delivery mechanism has to evolve.
This isn't direct contact. Infect those closest and let nature run its course. This is systematic targeting.
Geographic dissemination. I have to give the vaccine its best chance.
London, Phoenix, New York, the UN, you used tonight to pull us all together, to turn us into homemade bioweapons. Oh, my God! Why didn't you just rig up some aerosol bombs and hit a few subway cars?
Because that would draw unnecessary attention. That would draw in Homeland Security, the CDC, every agency under the sun, the news. Mm. If I wanted that type of attention, I would simply release the full-blown Belgian virus and call it a day. This way is quiet. It's effective.
It's bioterrorism.
Is it? Pull up the Belgian virus. Pull up Daddy. No? I'll do it.
Sebastian turns on another screen. There's another virus. This one resembles the Eye of God virus, but it's bigger looking, more complex, more intense, more beautiful, and more terrifying at the same time.
Wow. No offense, Bass, but that's a virus.
None taken. Well?
Markers are there.
The markers are there, and?
They are related. Made that phone call.
Oh, God, Catherine, if you reach up to the CDC, they will destroy that.
Shouldn't they? You have created a vaccine that's built too much like the disease. Vaccines are supposed to work with dead elements of viruses. They're supposed to have their protein stripped to prevent mass replication. They're only meant to live and die inside us long enough to train our bodies to recognize the larger threat. They're not supposed to be the threat.
So your dad's vaccine is actually a vaccine to that piece of work?
It's another virus, smaller, but it's a virus.
So it's chickenpox.
What?
Didn't your dad ever give you chickenpox? When I was a kid, my best friend, she got it bad. We were like 5, I think. My mom said Amelia was sick, but then she took me over there anyway. I didn't understand because every time either of us had been sick before, they separated us like we had the plague. But there we were, stuck together in a room for days. Mom wanted me to get it, catch it right there and fight it back so I wouldn't have to deal with it later.
And it worked, didn't it?
No. By the time they realized Amelia had it and got me over there, she wasn't contagious. It worked out for her. She had someone to keep her company in quarantine.
So you never got chicken pox?
I used to volunteer in college at this after-school program, St. Hedwig's, tutoring kids and playing baseball with them. And when you know it, one of them got chicken pox. So I got chicken pox. And it's much worse as an adult. I thought I was going to die. I couldn't help thinking, in all my suffering, wouldn't it have been nice to catch this years ago? Maybe I wouldn't have it now.
Or your mom could have just gotten you the chickenpox vaccine shot, a normal way of being vaccinated.
I'm sure she did. But those wear off, and not everyone gets a booster. She meant the best for me, I know that now. I wish I could have told her that.
I'm so sorry.
Is it possible that your dad means the best for you two?
Does this mean you trust me, Parker?
I trust in God. I trust that he will point me on the right path.
Do you honestly think that that path points anywhere near my father? How is it you refer to God again, Dr. Riley?
I am the furthest from spiritual you will probably ever meet. I follow science. In science, there is empirical evidence, there are absolutes, and there are concrete foundations upon which to rest my beliefs.
And yet you took a leap of faith.
Rooted in logical reasoning.
You didn't have all the evidence. It's the reason the CDC rejected your distribution proposal. And still, you leapt. A leap of faith is a leap of faith. You see the world through one lens. I see it through two. God and science. There's a chance I'm here tonight because I'm supposed to be.
You think we should be okay with this? I mean, you actually believe him?
I believe in trusting my odds.
Odds are you could die.
If I do nothing, I'll die. If I do something, I'll die. No matter what path I take, Catherine, death is always waiting for me. For all of us. The roads diverge here. The question I have to ask is why not try and take the longer road? A whole village, right? Gone in a week. How many people?
More than 300.
Died.
In the village. Only 17 survived.
And you were one of them. There's no logic to that. But I can believe that there's a reason.
Parker.
Catherine, I know you're scared.
I am not scared.
Good. Neither am I.
Parker collects two vials from the cooler and brings one to Catherine.
Go on. It won't hurt you.
She holds one.
This right here? It seems to me that it's the longer road. Your father saw death coming and decided to do something about it.
Not all death, just one. And where is your God in all of this? Surely he's not going to condone the slaughtering of innocent people.
No, he wouldn't.
Catherine, I think the only fair question is if God's children had the means to save themselves from a plague, would he deny them those means? What kind of God would that be?
Fine. This is not a theological debate.
No, it's biological. It's science. Your father's work, his research, you followed in his footsteps your whole life.
Yes, I have.
Then why are you so reluctant to follow him now?
He's made mistakes.
Everyone does. You could. The CDC could.
If this works faster than it should, you have meds you can give me to keep me going,
ready,
right?
Waiting.
Do you believe him? I, for one, do. I've read his work. There's a reason I wanted to write about Sebastian Riley. I believe in him.
It scares you.
No, it doesn't. It shouldn't.
You ever look at the face in the mirror and you don't see yourself? You see a belief in God or man or science, it depends on the day. You see what you need to see so that you can sleep at night. What that belief wants you to see, because you're playing with people's lives every day. So that you know that those things you find yourself doing must be good. They have to be, right? That what you do helps people.
This will help people.
But what if that is just the belief talking, infecting the worst parts of you, and then you're nothing but a sick, sick man.
Then I'm already sick.
You sound like an acolyte.
Believing in a man doesn't make me an acolyte, Catherine. In this instant, it makes me smart.
I was starting to think that you were becoming a danger to yourself, but now it's clear you are dangerous to those around
if
you.
If people are driven by their nature, if they make their own choices, then he would have always chosen this path. I'm not forcing him to do anything.
He's not a danger. Or some snake oil salesman, and he's not a savior. I'm not an idiot. What he is, though, is right. This is as much about belief as it is about playing the odds. I have to look at that bottom line. It's all about survival. There is a threat globally unprecedented, just itching to kill us all. You know it. The CDC knows it. And while you and your team there might come up with a vaccine, let's say you do. What are the chances that it will get to me in time? 90%, the man said, not of getting your cure, but of getting dead. 90% chance of being wiped off the planet. Those are not good odds. Looking at me, myself, I have to give myself my best chance. Not just me, but everyone. Do you think the world can handle a loss like that? 90% of the population drops in a week, Catherine, a week. That will kill us all. The hospitals will be overrun. Martial law will take effect to try and curb the panic and the looting. Supplies will vanish from overuse and hoarding. There won't be enough places to put the sick, let alone bury the dead. Where do you bury 6 billion people? The strain of that much chaos, that much death, so quickly will break the infrastructure. The center will not hold. We will drown in ourselves. Look at what your mother's death...
You do not get to invoke her for your arguments.
What it did to you, to your father, to your family, that's one life. I have been there. I have stood there in the hospital watching monitors and doctors and that little number that keeps the heart rate. I have watched it drop until the count reaches zero. I have stood helpless,
But this little vial, that one, they represent a fighting chance. If this would have saved your mother, would you keep it locked in a bunker? It will still be horrible. It will knock us to our knees. But we can get back up from this.
Parker opens his vial. Then he gestures to the Belgian virus.
Not from that.
Catherine opens her vial, too.
Last chance to stop.
I don't think I can.
Parker lifts the vial in a toast, then downs his vial quick as he can. Catherine does not.
There's something larger than all of us out there.
You're talking about God or death?
He's talking about life.
I need a minute.
I know it's tough to understand, Catherine. That's why I needed you to be here, so I could show you.
I understand it. What troubles me is that you're okay with letting some people die just so that others might live. You're okay with it. His God is okay with it.
What troubles me is that you aren't.
Accepting a percentage of risk should have limits. Your theory wasn't fleshed out.
Theories and proposals are nothing but potential left on the table.
What's wrong with potential? Accelerating development on an untested vaccine. The Sebastian Riley who taught me would have called this radical, reckless.
But the CDC can call it radical or a hide from it. But when it's in your hand, it all becomes clear. Isn't that right, Parker?
Parker doesn't respond. He looks confused.
Maybe he's having second thoughts.
Parker stumbles a bit.
Something's wrong.
Sebastian steadies him.
It's all right. Take a breath.
Parker coughs, and it gets worse, like he's starting to choke.
Lacerated pain.
Parker, you need to talk to me. Tell me what's going on.
I can't breathe.
He's having a reaction to the vaccine.
That doesn't make sense.
Sense or not, something is happening. Help me get him to a chair.
You saw me take it and I'm fine.
His skin is flushed.
It's not supposed to cause a reaction like this.
Parker fully collapses.
His breathing's impeded. His throat's swelling.
It could be anaphylaxis. You may be allergic.
Or you maybe did something wrong. I'm going for help.
You'd be dead by then. Third drawer. The right.
Catherine rushes over to search the lab supply drawers.
Parker, you're going to anaphylactic shock.
It's not anaphylaxis.
We can handle this, Catherine. Epinephrine. Third drawer.
Everything always works out for you, doesn't it?
Not everything.
You've never had to suffer repercussions.
She turns, holding an EpiPen. Parker's on the floor, Sebastian next to him. She freezes.
What are you doing? Get here.
Catherine keeps her distance.
He's dying.
Because of you.
What?
This is your design. You made this vaccine. You play God.
Sebastian cradles Parker, who is quietly struggling for air, spasms hitting him as his body tries to get oxygen.
Catherine, please.
It's harder to watch them die in front of you, isn't it?
What? This is your chance to get closer to what you want. This threat to contain. This vaccine to die here in this bunker.
This isn't about me.
Oh, no, he's dangerous, is that it? So am I, then. By your weapons, you call.
I did not put him in this position. You did this to Parker.
You are holding the power to save a life, and you would deny him that.
How many lives would you deny?
Oh, you stand there and feel justified that letting Parker slip away will save all those innocent people in Phoenix and Denver and Kansas City? It is no different than what I am trying to do.
One man
is worth thousands. And those thousands are worth millions and so forth. How many lives would I deny? To save yours, to save your mother, all of them.
Sebastian stands and steps away. Parker is just about gone.
You're right. It's harder when they're right in front of you. You stand there, you watch him go.
Catherine stands there, Sebastian watches her.
I'm sorry.
Parker thrashes in pain. Catherine suddenly runs to him and injects the EpiPen into Parker's thigh. He doesn't move. They watch him for any sign. Sebastian gets the whiskey. He doesn't bother to get a glass. Parker gasps in some air. He instinctively tries to right himself.
Hey. Don't move, don't move. He's not going anywhere.
They.
No, don't. Are you okay?
He'll live.
Parker, we need to get you some medical treatment.
Thirsty.
Sebastian offers the whiskey.
Water.
I'm sorry, Parker. I'm not sure what happened.
This
is why we don't do things like this in home labs. This is exactly the kind of thing I was afraid of. This is why the CDC should be handling this. There is too much risk involved.
Yes, there is.
Your reckless behavior has put everyone in danger. You, Parker, me.
He wasn't going to die, Catherine. You never would have let it happen.
That wasn't your risk to take.
I'm fine. I'm fine. I'm still here.
Barely.
Barely is something.
Parker, I'm sorry.
People make mistakes.
I almost let you die.
Oh.
If I hadn't given you the EpiPen.
That was a question.
You'd be dead right now, but a lot of other people wouldn't be.
Then why did you save me?
Catherine gets up and goes to the workstation where the monitors are.
Catherine, what are you doing?
I am pulling up my mother's file.
You said you wouldn't.
Parker asked me if that vaccine could have saved Mom. Would I have used it? I need to know the answer to that question. Wait. This is strange.
What's wrong?
I don't have access to her file.
Maybe because she's your mother.
No. I don't have access to the Yosemite files from that outbreak. Any of them. They wouldn't classify something so basic unless...
Unless it wasn't something so basic.
If they misidentified it, they wouldn't advertise that mistake. Especially if they didn't figure it out right away. Look up Kiev. Look up Melbourne. Hong Kong. The files you've read before. Go on. Check them.
Catherine does another file search. No results.
Huh. They're not there anymore, are they?
The redacted file doesn't mean anything.
It means something. Catherine, we don't redact things unless we're trying to protect ourselves from it. Maybe the file not being there says everything you needed to say.
That's not good enough.
What are you doing?
I'm hacking the CDC. He shouldn't have, but Roger shared his access code with me.
Look at him finally being good for something.
You didn't answer my question, Catherine.
Parker, in theory, I said I couldn't sacrifice all those people to save however many more, but there you were. You were dying. And I had the power to stop it. Thought about Roger. About him getting sick, really sick, worst case, with Belgium. Like you said, we can't come back from a loss like that. I thought about my mom, how helpless I felt to save her, and it was happening again, and I remembered what was in my hand. For one small second, I was not helpless. I had to protect you. I barely had time to think about it.
You thought of it. Catherine, you would have always saved him. It's in your nature to do the right thing, to make the right choice. Whether it's 300 million or 500,000, you said it yourself. The number of people in the sacrificial lamb column is irrelevant if it's more than one. When it's one, that's when it makes all the difference.
We hear the computer beep affirmatively.
I'm in.
Catherine pulls up the file.
For file?
Hong Kong, Melbourne, Kiev, Yosemite. Oh, and Helen. Original diagnosis, inconclusive, unidentified. Death, the result of cytokine storm.
I'm sorry, Kev.
This virus has haunted me since Belium. I haven't been able to sleep for months. As I still wake up hearing the cries of the children in that village calling out for their dead parents. Children who couldn't be held by anyone who wasn't wrapped up in a containment suit and plastic helmets. They died, bereft of human contact, gasping for anyone, reaching out, their organs shut down, and they choked on their own blood. My Helen. I am so sorry I wasn't able to be there. You have no idea how sorry. I think about her every day. I have since the day I walked into the shop in Paris, and I haven't stopped. I won't stop. I lost her. I refuse to lose you. I'm sorry that in my obsession to assure that I did anyhow. I see that now.
You never lost me. You just pushed me away. You wanted Mom's death to be something that you could fight. I think the reason that I didn't want that to be true is because it was easier if it was something I couldn't fight. You know, if it was just something that happened, something I couldn't stop. You don't have to feel responsible when there's nothing that you can
you're,
do.
You're not responsible. No. Don't blame yourself. There was nothing we could do.
We let it take her.
No, we didn't. We didn't know. None of us.
I would have saved her if she were here. And I knew it was coming and I had it in my hand. Dad, I don't know what I'm supposed to do.
Sebastian pulls a small note card from his pocket.
This was for tonight. The way ahead is full of pitfalls and difficulties. This is far from exhilarating. The past, equally pocked by tragedy. We are flawed as a species. We let ambition blind us. We forget those who stand at our sides. We lose them sometimes because of arrogance or pride. We're sorry for the love we cannot give. It makes demons of us all. This life, this world, it is frightening. It is real. There are more questions than answers. In the end, we can only look at the evidence, at the data, and hope that we may have to make a decision that affects life and death, that we have the fortitude to make the right call, that we have the strength, whether it comes from science, God, each other, or a good whiskey to do so. Strength, as demonstrated by Dr. Catherine Riley. My daughter. My proudest achievement, I'd like to claim. Her mother, Helen, would remind me that it was our achievement, but she was Helen's. I was not a father without that woman as her mother. Helen instilled in her a gift for understanding the world, looking out for us and doing right. It seems fitting that she received this medal tonight. Presidium means protection. Trust me when I tell you all. We're in very good hands.
Catherine hugs Sebastian. She then walks back to the cooler unit on the table. She takes her vial and holds it. She raises it in a toast.
Are you sure about this?
There's no going back.
Couldn't if we wanted. Belgium wasn't isolated. Just didn't want to see what was right in front of us. The threat is real. The roads diverge here. Dad, get Parker his antivirals. He'll need them in a couple of days.
should go home and rest. And you should stop by a hospital before your flight to Phoenix. You've had a rough time.
Yes, Doc.
Sebastian hands Parker a small box.
Instructions are inside.
It's Mom.
She downs the vial. She takes a moment.
Are we good?
So far? Yeah, we're good.
Then you should get to your gala. You've got an award to accept. I've got some notes to jot down about the first chapter of Sebastian's biography.
I'd want to leave a few details out.
This is going to win me a Pulitzer. Don't worry. I'll make us all look good.
Parker heads up the stairs and opens the hatch door.
And Bass? Hmm. You can write my speech.
Parker exits. Sebastian gathers two more antiviral kits for him and Kat.
Do we have to go?
It's your night, Pumpkin. I'm sorry, Catherine.
It's all right. I've missed being your daughter. For being honest.
Me too.
They cross to the stairs, switch off the lights, exit through the hatch, and close it behind them, leaving the stage in darkness. End of play.
Sounds really great, but.
So, was there something about the character, a quality about the character that popped for you? When you say archetypal journalist, I was just curious about how you would describe that. What's the adjective about an archetypal?
Well, he amplified a lot. I mean, I'm not a scientist.
Yeah.
He amplified a lot of those emotions and thoughts that I would have when things got very scientific. So almost like a, it was like if Ferris Bueller went to journalism school.
That's actually what I watched.
No, you gave away all your secrets, Patrick. No, it's really interesting. And I thank you very much for that. What else?
For you.
Cool. Thank you. What else?
That too took me
That's what somebody said the other night, that it's the first thing that popped in their head was that it's real.
Oh, yeah.
It felt very current.
It is real.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, as Clark said, there's outbreaks in your
body
now, so there's certainly a little bit of resonance there.
Yeah.
I don't know if I already used my one token for the French viewer thing.
I'll give you another one.
Yeah, you know, there was the sort of arc apex for me was when it was compared that the belief in God is just, one might say that it's viral and it, like, you know, the belief that carries the journalist character, you know, has its own, it spreads by the same methods that the virus does. I thought when it was, I believe, the dialogue between you two, I thought that was really moving.
Well, I was very touched with the father-daughter rift and not communicating and not really understanding, and that happens with lots of fathers and daughters and all of that. And there was a line that Patrick had something about evil, the fact that
God doesn't
evil
put
exists.
Evil people in this world. Evil exists, and we come along and pick it up and play with it.
Play with it. Oh, I love that line. Yeah, that was a good line.
I saw a lot of heads nodding with reference to the father-daughter relationship. Did anybody else want to comment on that? Did it resonate with you in some way? Yeah?
It meant a lot to me to see it depicted as her wanting his approval of her work as a scientist and that kind of validation, because I think usually it's more something you see with the father and son to be like that. To respect that it was her as a professional.
About the science part of the story. What pops for you about that? Do you still have some questions about it? Did you feel intrigued by it? Were you lost by it? I mean, really, just what about the science, the component? We're all not scientists, although the last time we read this, we had a virologist to the audience.
Yes. Can I tell them what happened?
Please tell the story.
Before we started that night, we were talking about, we had our scripts open, and we were like, okay, so here's all the science stuff. Is everything cool? Everything? Those are the. And Jeremy said, yeah, we're good. As long as there's not a virologist in the audience. And there was!
She was explaining it to Patrick, who obviously didn't know what was going on. But I thought it explained it to the audience in a way that didn't make us feel like we were going through a lecture, in virology class or something. But again, it succinctly put it in, of course, there might have been a few errors. You'll have to talk to your virologist for anything. But it put it in a little package that was easy for me to get, okay, that's where they're from, this is what they do, and it didn't overwhelm me.
Okay. Do we have a thought about that?
I think that the brilliant thing was his intelligence level and his knowledge of what they were talking about anyway.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't like they had to simplify it down to science for dummies.
Mm-hmm.
They could still talk to him and explain it to him, how he would understand it, so we also didn't feel like it was, oh, by the way, this is what each of these things are. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I thought that was a great sort of, he was at their level enough that they could explain it, and she has a few instances where she goes, oh, okay, but it was all done, it wasn't more talked down to for the science, which I think really helped make us feel, well, I get this, it's okay, I was with you.
Even like the SSR doobie doobies,
this is a comfortable level of scientific literacy. I mean, some of my favorite moments happen because it wasn't that, because there was no pumping of those brakes. I thought they provided a great context for a lot of the father-daughter things and a lot of God things. Those to be woven through the context of science was really great for me.
Yeah.
I would not want it to be walked back at all.
Gotcha. Good, thank you. Very helpful. Anybody else on that? Okay, so I'm also curious about your feeling about the sort of basic philosophical moral question being posed here about the few versus the many, who gets to choose, all those potential issues relative to that. How did you feel about that component of the play? Did you have an opinion that was influenced in some way about that? Were you surprised about how you felt about that conversation? Were you surprised about where it went relative to how you understood the characters? Anybody have any thoughts about that? Yeah.
Well, it reminded me a lot of this sort of classic question that has to do with how framing affects people's responses, right? And there's this question you can ask people. You say, well, you have control of the switch and the train's coming, and if you throw the switch, you're going to kill a third of the people standing by the train tracks. And then people will answer that, do you throw the switch? And people answer a certain way. And then you frame it the opposite way, and you say, if you throw the switch, you save two-thirds of the people, or something like that, right? Mm-hmm. It's the same issue, but it's framed differently. And people respond differently to that, actually, on average, right?
Right.
And I might not have the question exactly right, but I kept thinking about that in terms of how she faced the EpiPen choice. She had to make it a certain way to be true to herself. But when she faced the abstract question of, could I be the one that delivers death to 5% of the world's population, I can't be the one to do that, right? But I thought that was really good how the playwright put a little mini case in there.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Anybody else have any thoughts about that?
I was impressed that it was balanced back and forth, the arguments on both sides of those. Each character had different ways of viewing it, and therefore I got a lot of the argument of pro and con through the discussion between them. I thought that was cool.
Yeah, thank you. Did anybody feel pulled one way or the other in particular, or not? Yeah?
Well, I kind of went, I guess a little different than that, because it was the time when she changed her mind and the time when Patrick changed his mind, and I'm probably what drove Ryan in the first place was to save, it goes back to that survival question, to save himself. They didn't care until she thought about Roger. He didn't care until he remembered the fact that he had to sit and watch his mom die. So then he thinks about all the people who he's gonna have, that he knows who he might have to sit and watch die,
mm-hmm.
of the Belgium. And so then they say, well, I won't die if I take this vial because I'll get all these medicines. And then people I love won't die because they're gonna get this virus and all the other virus. So then, well, 5% of the population, I don't know. All right, I'll take this vial and maybe we'll save 85% of the population. But also, let's not think about the fact that the people I don't know are going to die, and that's okay because they're not in the room next to me.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not making that decision about them. I'm making a decision about those that are sitting right next to me. That's why I thought about why they made that decision.
Yeah.
Not that she thought, oh, I'm going to save 300 million people, but I'm going to save, I wish I could say it like you say, Roger.
Yeah, yeah.
Of course, they were going to go wipe out the Cambridge University and the UN.
Because they were going to spread it to the UN.
Maybe
they
not everybody.
Go back all over the world.
Yeah, it wasn't 100%.
Yeah.
Valley.
Come on. 5%.
What do you think? This is a sort of an English teacher question, so I apologize. But like tomorrow when you're telling someone about this play, hey, I saw this cool play reading at Tennessee Rep last night, and it was about, what's your gut response about that short answer? Yeah.
I actually, from what you described, I think it subverts, a lot of these questions about, you know, how diseases spread that are really infectious are a lot very similar to like big data questions. The human mind sucks at them, like random things and things that spread like that. We don't really humanize really well. We play those games really badly,
yeah.
You know. But the I like that that a lot of the when a lot of the things that drive those choices for the characters are the individual people. You know, it's Roger, it's the mother, it's the wife, and it sort of subverts the sort of big data chance game of who gets infected, and sort of you know replaces that with this model of people, and that is we're better at that. Like that's a better game to play mentally than like 5% of random based off of these thousands of factors.
Right.
You know. So it humanizes and subverts the virus question.
Right.
Is that an English teacher answer?
Nope.
You're right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. All
right. I'm gonna bring Jerry back to life now. You can come up and join your actors if you want.
So many things. One of my favorite books in probably the world is Stephen King's The Stand, which if you haven't read it is about a bunch of people who survive a massive apocalyptic viral outbreak that decimates everybody but like, you know, the 300 people who live in Boulder in Las Vegas. I was very interested in kind of going back to the beginning of where something like that begins, and taking it all the way back to the beginning and even like just before that genesis of the end of the world, because I like contagion movies and pathogen movies and all that thing, and it is kind of terrifying the things that are happening. Like while working on this play this season, reading about unidentified strain appears in New Guinea and takes out 60% of the people it hits, which actually is a variant of the Zaire Ebola virus, which is now hitting New Guinea, and that's very real. In the last like month, like hundreds of people have been killed very quickly by this thing. So it is very terrifying. So I wanted to explore that, but I wanted to explore it very theatrically, just intimately, with a very small kind of microcosm of a very big thing. So that's kind of where it all. Yeah,
okay.
That's what I wanted to play with. Play viruses on stage.
He's a dark and twisted man, I'm telling you. So what do you want to know from Jeremy? What can he talk to you about?
Well, I have a question. It's not in this play at all, but one of the really big issues at the moment are all these parents who are deliberately not having their children vaccinated, where we pretty much think that the vaccine is going to work. That's sort of the opposite mirror thing of people being deniers, you know, that this can be.
Yeah, it's a facet of that fascination of what's the truth.
Well,
about
that's one reason this will work.
Yeah.
They don't get to choose.
Yeah.
I wondered about how what you saw and envisioned when you put it in a bunker. I guess I started off with a kind of a cement bunker, kind of scary and dark, but as we kind of went on, I was like, oh, well, obviously this is not a 1960s bunker. Like it has to have, when the computer screens and stuff turn on, then I was like, oh, well, this has got to be really pretty high tech actually for what's going on. So did you imagine it that way? Like that it was, that you would always walk in and be like, boom, you're in outbreak? Or you work in like a bunker, and then all of a sudden, when she turned on the computers, it was like boom.
In my head, like, you know, $1 million budgets. I think a combination of that. Like I won't, in my head, it has like the look of that, like remnants of the 1960s, but with clearly he has augmented the space to make it his, and while it used to be this like place to, depending on your point of view, hide from something scary or to shield and protect you from it, he is taking the shield and protect, and he kind of turned that into, I can use this place to create something that will shield and protect. Something that, you know, is what he's doing very dangerous and illegal, so it's not like he could be in his actual university lab. So I like that it was like subterranean and underground, and just very like, he's down here tinkering in his hovel, as she calls it. So that's why I wanted it to be an underground lab, and as it kind of evolved in my head, I was like, a bunker would be really cool. I'm also equally fascinated by bunkers. there's ones you can like buy in Las Vegas that are like whole houses underground, and it just fascinates me that, you know, the preparedness of living in that environment people went to protect themselves, and kind of spinning that into here. But in a theatrical version, I made it a more intimate little bunker. It's not a sprawling state. It's it's more of a little, you know, yeah, bubble. Yeah. They're in their bubble.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Well, I was intrigued by the Presidium Award she was getting, and the fact that the bunker could be viewed as a Presidium, and the fact that the virus could be the Presidium virus. And that all sort of mixed together, and I thought that was really cool. The fact that the Presidium Award was there gave a way to talk about that word and how it could be applied. That was cool.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I actually don't know the answer to this, and I'm curious. Can you talk about your journey into deciding that Catherine would take the vaccine? Was that always decided?
No. Her decision evolved throughout the process of writing the play. As I myself grappled with whether or not she would, I eventually came to, and whether this is just me, I came to this realization that either they were walking out of this bunker at the end of the play, or they were all going to be dead. That part didn't interest me. It was more interesting to get her to a point where she would take that virus, as I began to play with her father and her relationship and whether or not they could reconcile. And I wanted that reconciliation, and for me, her taking that was part and parcel to that reconciliation and bringing them together. So it just kind of developed as their relationship became a big part of this story.
Yes, ma'am.
I just have another question about the evolution of the play. There's a turn that I'm really glad it didn't take, but I was starting to wonder if it was going to go in this direction. The whole thing about the computer and looking up and getting into the CDC files, I had this fear that we were going down the route where the virus turns out to have been leaked out of the U.S. labs, right? Mm-hmm. And that's how it showed up in California and stuff like that. And of course, you know, there's a theories and conspiracy theories and stuff about where viruses have come from in the past and stuff like that. I think that the way it worked out is great because reality is actually much scarier than a conspiracy. I mean, it would be really comforting if how bad things get could be explained by some, you know, intentional human action instead of a lot of bad choices. But did you ever think about that route because of the way people think about viruses?
I never really thought about going to the point where maybe it was total conspiracy. If there was any conspiracy things that I played with along the evolution of this, and the actors and I talked about this, and so does the lab, more about a cover-up and kind of building that into a bigger thing. And it's kind of, it's in there, but it's not like full-blown they're taking out. They're still working on it. But the conspiracy things, I mean, Parker has some lines about conspiracies, and his even suggestion about was Spanish flu something that we did and sent over there, and there, whether that's conspiracy, whether that was just, you know, avian flu hitting people in Kansas and it happened to spread. So I played with it a little bit, but not a lot. I much more like the idea that these viruses that have cropped up over the centuries and things that break out are trying to survive on their own, and they're trying to live, and so they're popping up as they're trying to live, which unfortunately hurts us. And so,
yeah. If you would have ran like the simulation of you writing this play 100 times, how many times did Parker die?
Four.
You was gonna live most of the time. I didn't know if that was something you came down on, like every he's gonna live, he's gonna die, but he was like he was gonna live most of the time.
He died a few times in the really early drafts.
You
would be amazed at the evolution that Parker.
What was one of the first incarnations of Parker?
Oh, you're really gonna make
Please,
me tell
yes.
this.
You don't have to go all the way back.
Oh no, you probably should.
Oh yes.
No, Evelyn knows the first. Yeah, so Brian knows. Parker was originally brought in as a test subject, but the way that he was originally brought in, Parker was a male escort.
Hired by...
That Sebastian brought in because he needed to infect somebody, and he thought this is the easiest way to get that.
Wow.
Which worked for a while in the drafting process, but as characters get fleshed out and things change, Parker started evolving as much as the virus, and in each draft, he had a new profession. He had a new viewpoint, and slowly over the year, and especially after our midpoint in January, he started to really shift gears, and then heading into the festival sometime around March, I minored in journalism in college, and my own journalistic brain kicked in and said, I'm just going to make him a writer. I tend to not like to put writers in my plays because I'm a writer. And I'm like, well. But I was like, no, in this case, I actually, once Parker became this character and became a journalist and a writer, he came alive for me and found his voice. And a lot of the play kind of, that third of the play, his third, really took off and then informed a lot of theirs. So it just felt right, so I kept going. That's the fun of this lab. We got to surprise them every month. Like, what's Parker gonna be? It's like a game.
It's interesting, though, isn't it? I mean, it really has been fascinating to watch over the season. Anybody else have a question before we part company?
I got one, just curious, because of the call the other night. Did Parker's transformation, his idea to go on and take it, did it seem too abrupt? We had this the other night, and did it seem to really flow? It meant follow organically this time for you all.
I thought it was logical with his thinking. He's not a long deliberator in any of his arguments. He knows where he's going, and he listens and he hears, but then he makes his decision. Right. So I did not find that in any way abrupt.
Yeah, I think it fit with his faith. In the way that he understood it. Not that it necessarily fits with faith, but in Parker's faith it did.
Right.
Cool. Thank you so much for being here. Thank you.
May I say something?
Yes.
May I say something?
Okay.
Sorry to interrupt you. I just wanted to say, I think it's all, I love that you are all here. Thank you so much for coming. These people have been amazing. And I love the fact that the ones tonight and the next three nights are streamed on HowlRound. So tell your friends in other places. They can tune in and watch. For example, my friend from Virginia sent me a picture of her cat watching my play tonight. So people are watching these things. So hello to everyone on the internet. But tell your friends in Nashville to come back this week. But tell your friends not in Nashville that they can take part in this discussion and part of this development online. I think it's fantastic.
Thank you so much for throwing that in. It's very important. By the way, I really enjoyed the intermission.